So I'm here with John Righten, who is, you're an author, aren't you? But you've also had a more of a career, John, in travelling, going abroad and doing aid missions in a way. So we're going to, for this episode of Vote, we're going to be talking about your books, but also your life. So let's start off from the start. What provides the content for the books and your experiences in delivering aid to various parts of the world, really?
Well, it started off like most things in life in terms of, you know, it was an accident. And it happened in the end of the 80s, where a friend of mine, she asked me to help to get some clothes together. And footage had come out in terms of the orphans in Romania and the abuse that they were going through and the appalling conditions. So I said, well, I've got a lot of contacts, you know, I can get some clothes. Got all that together, and then once we brought all this together, then said, well, wait, okay, where's the truck? And then there was this look from her, and you know, whenever she would do this and go, well, then we knew we were in trouble, because there was no truck, there was no paper, you know, let alone paperwork to get it through. So through that, I had to set up the truck and all the paperwork, work out how to get all this stuff through. And then we started to get more donations of medicine and building material. And we went off to Romania, we helped renovate an orphanage there. And from there, it kind of grew. And, you know, what I saw there, it's like, this is something that, you know, I may not have many skills, but this is something I could contribute to.
Yeah, and you were talking about the period of Romania when obviously it was just under, just before Ceausescu left the scene, right?
What happened was, yeah, it was about then, in terms of just before he was he was executed.
Yeah.
But at the same time, the government at the time was looking very much for resources from the West and saying, right, he's gone now, you know, let's have this investment, let's start, you know, building the infrastructure, the hotels and all this and the tourists. But the problem is there was a major problem in terms of the amount of street children. Because under Ceausescu, they didn't have the resources to build all the big bridges, but they put the message out and virtually made it law, is that, you know, women were treated like cattle to produce children. 10, 12, you know, children, but there was no money. So a lot of these children ended up on the street.
Yeah.
And that's really what happened. So when I was out there, it was shocking.
Yeah. And obviously that's it's improved a lot in recent times, but what experiences did you learn there, and how does that inform what you've put in your books?
I think very much is that one is that you're going to have bureaucrats that are going to say, oh, you need this particular stamp, and you know, like to get over a border, and you have this all the time. And I remember on that trip when we got to the border, one of the borders, and the border guards there came out and they said, no, new stamp as from this morning, you all have to turn back. And there was 6 truckloads of medical aid that had come from Germany, and they went, oh, right, if that's what we must do, and they turned around. And it was one of the saddest things I'd ever seen, was seeing those 6 trucks turn around. But we had this aid, and he was going to get there. So even though they produced guns and they were shouting, screaming, there was loads of trucks that had waited for days to get through behind us, we parked our truck there on the border, pretended to throw away the keys, and we said we were going nowhere. But we got through. Because, you know, they were so shocked by this. And I learned that lesson is that very much that when you get, no, this can't be done, yes, it can be done.
Yeah.
And that became very much like part of the books as well, in when you have like the bureaucrats or you have force and, you know, like those with guns. And it's like, oh, no, there is a way through.
Yeah.
And there's very much a kind of like a message of hope for all these books that it can be done.
Yeah. And let's go to the books. It's called Heartbreak, isn't it? And it's part of a trilogy. So what were the first set of books that you produced?
I did a book, and it was really the stories of all what I call the benevolent rogues that I met. And it was called the Benevolence of Rogues. And in that book, and I really enjoyed it, and it was to tell their stories. The spine was my kind of rites of passage and all my failings. But the main stories was about, you know, these amazing characters that maybe were not, you know, particularly acceptable in terms of careers or anything along those lines, but they had skills. I enjoyed writing that book so much that I thought, you know, I want to do something different. So I wrote a book about the 30s. And I just thought, well, what would happen if it came to those families that had to flee the Nazis? And I remember characters like Sir Nicholas Winton, and what he did with the Kilda trains,
yeah.
and managed to get the children out. And I thought, what about the rogues I'd met? What would happen if they? What would have happened if they were around in the 30s? And that's where that trilogy came from.
Yeah.
And it became a success. I mean, the first one, Churchill's Rogues, for example, that one that was shortlisted for the Wilbur Smith Award. And, you know, I met the best-selling author, you know, and it was really quite something, you know, to be shortlisted on my first novel.
Yeah.
And then after that, I wrote, this has gone really well, so I wrote a book on the 60s, and that was kind of like a crime espionage, but on an epic scale. But again, I was able to look at big themes in terms of the civil rights movement, sexual liberation, Elvis. So everything goes in. So much research, and to look at those events. And now with Heartbreak, that was now moving on another 30 years because I wanted a challenge, another 30 years, and to look at a new period of history, and that was to look at the 90s and very much my kind of my home ground in a way. In terms of, this young woman that is managing an orphanage in Ireland, and she sees the footage on television of what is happening in Romania, and she wants to do something, but she may be seen by many as unworldly, because she wants to help but doesn't know how. So she ends up joining a convoy of, again, kind of roguish characters who have done this kind of thing for many years. They don't patronize or anything. They kind of accept the way, you're a young woman and everything else. So it goes against her that she's female and she's young. But, they want to work with her. There's no pro forma you have to fill in, about to do this work. It's really, are you going to get this done? And they suddenly realize she has skills, that the way that she can assess a situation really quickly. And her courage. But she does things that in many ways, there's one incident, for example, in the book where they're in a bar, they bump into a load of mercenaries in a bar who will fight for any side, and in fact they're fighting for both sides. But she commits an act in that bar that has ramifications for all the rogues in terms of what she does. But that is really where the book is from. And it's her development, it's what she learns.
Yeah.
And she becomes the leader of these groups. It's really a story of inspiration, but it's a fast-paced thriller. It's been shortlisted now for the Page Turner Awards, and the follow-up Resilience has also been shortlisted for the awards for their unpublished category, and that's coming out next month.
Yeah. What, when you say rogues, what do you mean?
Well, when I wrote my first book, Benevolent Rogues, I looked at the rogues that I'd met. I grew up on a tough estate in London. Not looking for tears or anything. That was just that was the world I knew. And on that estate, there was a number of like roguish characters who were very much up for themselves. That was what it was about. Years later, I would come across what I would call, a very selective group that I call benevolent rogues. And they were people who had roguish traits, maybe sometimes, like on the border of the law, but they would. It wasn't just about them. They wanted to do something for the world. So when I would say to them, I need your help on something, these benevolent rogues would never put their hand up and volunteer. They weren't clean cut. Male or female, they weren't clean cut. They would never step forward.
Yeah.
But when it got really tough and people started to draw back, they were still there.
Yeah.
And it was those benevolent rogues, who helped me in terms of the aid missions and, some extraordinary people with, and also a lot of humour as well that helped me get it through it all, because they would have a different slant on things.
Yeah.
At the worst possible time, the worst possible mark, that could be thought of would be said, and it was like, but you would have to kind of like, in a way, laugh, and there were many incidents of that, and that comes up. There's humor in the books as well, and people would think, how can you tell these tragic stories? But there's an element of humor, and it's difficult, but it was important. And then you see the camaraderie that went on between those women and those, men, that did this kind of work, and that's how they got through it.
Yeah.
So things like that.
Yeah, so I know you went to Romania, but Sarajevo, which we're going to talk a lot about in the second half, were you not scared going there because of the atrocities that went on? Well, some of Europe's worst atrocities went on during those wars in the former Yugoslavia, didn't they? Mm. Since the Second World War, some of the worst atrocities we've seen.
I think that with Bosnia, that even though what I'd seen in Romania was horrendous, in many cases, there were the abusers, and we were working very closely with the police to kind of get these people and get them out and get them in court. With Bosnia, it was different. This was something that was going on. This was a war, obviously. And one of the things I remember was on the outsides of places like Sarajevo, Mostar, and you would see these ground-to-air missiles being lobbed in, and, you know, snipers, you know, in the distance. And it looked like Legoland without the color. If Lego was like all gray, and bits were just falling apart, and there was no windows, and you suddenly realize there's people inside those buildings. And that was the shock. And you'd see the press there, and the press would be, you know, they're saying, oh, well, this is, you know, and looking for airtime about what he's done. But it was brilliant that they were there to film this. And that really, because they shone a light on it, but there was only so far they could go. This is before NATO got involved and everything else. And I remember talking to one journalist, and oh, you imagine being down there. And I remember saying, well, actually, we're going to be down there in about 6 hours.
Yeah.
And, you know, and we did. But that's what we had to travel through these places and help. And heartbreaking.
Yeah. Join us for the second half, where we will talk more about Heartbreak, which is John Righten's new book. And we'll be speaking a lot more about his experiences in Sarajevo as well. Join us for the second half. So I'm back here with John Righten, who is the author of Heartbreak, which is your new book. And we were talking about Sarajevo in the first half. We'll quickly go back to Sarajevo. How much does that inform your writing experiences there? Because you must have seen a lot of bad things happen, and obviously a lot of those experiences might have been traumatic. So did that really kind of inform your writing, particularly when writing about trauma or grief in your writing?
Absolutely. That is something that is still there with me now. I suppose the one thing that kind of protected me in a way is kind of like being young and, you know, like the kind of sense of adventure, particularly being, you know, like that male ego thing. And isn't this great, you know, in a war and everything else. But it was really that time just realizing this is something completely different. This is a war in Europe that is like, we thought this was done. Probably the way that many people thought in the 1930s, that after the Great War, they would never see this in Europe again. Lo and behold, World War II. It was kind of all breaking out again. But you had, and it was almost like a training ground that was developing in Bosnia, because you had members of the Mujahideen that were coming from their fight in the Russians. You had members of the IRA that were puddling, you know, that suddenly appeared on the streets of Split in Croatia. Apartheid was coming to an end. You had members of the South African police. And these were people who suddenly found themselves that all they knew in many cases was how to torture, to kill, to maim. And this was their new training ground. This is how they made their money. And to be there for that, and then you saw what they were doing, and you thought, this is horrendous. And a lot of people that I worked with, a lot of those benevolent rogues, it affected them deeply in terms of addiction, drugs of all sorts. I mean, we all drank hard, you know, including myself, you know, like we all had that. But there was those in terms of drugs, there was over the years suicide, you know, for those that were people who came back from it and thought, particularly when you try to relate that kind of story to someone, and it's like, oh, right, you know, it's very difficult. And seeing what happened there, and then you thought of the children that you saw there, what would it be like for them for the future? What future does it have for them? And you see this now with things like Syria, it's ongoing. And those casualties will be there for generations that goes on, the mental trauma. The nearest I came to it was, and this sounds facetious, but I remember a girlfriend of mine long before I got married, you know, I probably fell over or something, and she accused me of being, she was laughing and said, you're a lunatic. And I thought, you know, I've got to put up some kind of flimsy defense here. And I said to her, you know, like, oh, you know, why have you got to, you know, to call me a lunatic? And she said, well, actually, I'm a psychiatrist. And that was the nearest that I'd kind of gone for it. But that was where the humor comes in, that kind of gallows humor. That's what got me through. But with others, the trauma that they went through. For example, there was a couple that I knew in Bosnia, very committed, very serious, very law-abiding, very straight, really lovely couple. He came back, he couldn't cope with it. He committed suicide. I met up with his girlfriend. We went to Spain to bury him. And then I brought her back to Paris. You know, we drove back after the funeral. And by the time I got to England, she'd killed herself. And you just thought that kind of trauma and everything else that I'd gone through.
Is that as a result of working in...
Yes.
In Sarajevo and Bosnia?
And Bosnia. I think the whole thing with Bosnia and everything else, that the, and you can imagine what it was like for those families, that what they went through then. And then, you know, and years later, you see in many countries the nationalist card being played again.
Yeah.
And it's like, but most people... certainly that I met, just wanted to get on with their lives. They just wanted to get on in terms of, you know, making sure their families were happy and healthy. And but then you'd have these politicians that would dig up stories from history of, like, you know, centuries ago, and saying, this is why we must go and sort this all out. And that's why that those people must be, you know, ethnic cleansing must be removed from your village.
Yeah.
And that's what's sad.
How did you deal with it every day then? Because obviously your life was at risk pretty much 24 hours a day. I mean, sleeping and, you know, did you ever think that you were going to get kidnapped? Or because how did people in Sarajevo, how did they react to people delivering aid?
I think that, we always got the most fantastic reception. But usually it was like looks of awe that we'd actually got through. Maybe further looks when they saw how dishevelled we were, you know, like, you know, in terms of our, you know, like the, you know, unshaven and everything else. So a lot of these people, they spent, you know, like they would do the best for their children on a daily basis to make sure they were washed and clean and smart. And we were the kind of like, we were the ragamuffins that were turning up. But the welcome was fantastic. And I remember in Bosnia, for example, big Bosnian tradition was like they would put loads of food on the table. And then you'd realise that they didn't have anything left in the fridge.
Yeah.
And you'd be saying, no, I can't. Thanks very much, but I can't. You know, please keep this. And he went, no. You know, this means a lot to us, is that you come here and you, the hospitality, and you thought you're in the middle of a war. You know, like you're being bombed in the evening. You're under curfew, and to have that kind of humanity and generosity was, even now, it still strikes me. You know, in terms of extraordinary.
Yeah, just talk a bit about Peru as well. So what happened in Peru? I know you went to South America. Is that, that's covered in the books as well, is it?
That comes up because the book, in a way, is that the heroine, Lenka, she covers, you know, like the, what I did in terms of Romania, Bosnia, and then later on South America. But I wanted to do the book, and sorry to go off at a tangent, I wanted to do the book from a woman's perspective. And that was because I could simply do, you know, another story, kind of like the adventurism and everything else. The way that the women looked in terms of the humanitarian aid work was very different in terms of making sure that they were always focused on the object in terms of getting the aid through. There was no time, if there were slurs or anything else that was made by people at borders, I might bite. They didn't. It's like, really, why are we doing this? And so that's where the book comes from. And in the end, she does this aid mission in terms of across South America. And I ended up doing that because, to be honest, once I finished with Bosnia, I was burnt out. I couldn't, you know, I was a lot older. And when you're driving all the time. It's not, because sometimes you could be driving for 3 days nonstop because you had to get through because of hijackers or all sorts of things. Or if you parked up, your fuel will be siphoned when you're asleep. So it was, and it took its toll on me. But I had a really good friend, Rory, who helped me on, you know, like who I'd bump into. So there was all things like that. But I think on the whole, you know, like that, I haven't come out of it too bad when I look at those and what they went through.
Yeah, and of course you. I mean, what does it take for someone to, like? We all get upset when we see, you know, images on our screen of war zones. But what does it take to go the extra mile and to actually go to those places and to help out those people in need?
I think because an analogy I would make is what we're going through now with COVID-19. And you saw that, I mean, for example, I kept my truck license, HGV license going. So I was able to help with some medical aid during this time. There were other people who just thought, I've got my family and everything else, I can't get involved in that, or I don't have a license. But they would go on their doorstep and they would clap. And I just thought, that's brilliant, because everyone is trying to do their own bit in their own way. And at that time, when I did the aid work, it was really just me. You know, like, wasn't particularly good at relationships. My wife would probably, you know, like, confirm that now. You know, what had, you know, so anything along those lines. So it was really, you know, what was there to lose? And I always made a point that whenever I did these, wouldn't have anyone that would have family, you know, because obviously, you know, didn't want that kind of responsibility, and you knew that it was going to be tough. But there were others, you know, these rogues that would come forward. So I did all that. But the one thing that, and I often get approached, and they're saying, oh, I want to do something like Syria. I want to do something now, do some aid work. And what I say to them is no. And the reason why is that the world has changed. When I was involved and the Benevolent Rogues were involved in that kind of thing, we weren't the set target. You know, like they would want to get what we were carrying because of its mainly because they thought, you know, we were helping the enemy, which wasn't the case. We didn't matter to us whether they were Muslim or Croat or Serbo-Croat. Didn't matter. You know, it was a hospital, it was being bombed, and we wanted to get the aid to them. That's all that mattered. But now what you see with aid workers, they become like they're merchandise now in terms of many wars. If you capture one, you know, you can hold the other, you can hold charities to hostage, you can demand money, ransom, and all sorts of things. That didn't happen then. So at the time, as I say, I got involved because I had nothing to lose and it was a great adventure. But I kind of evolved at the time, just realized this is not just an adventure.
And Syria is a brutal war, isn't it? It's one of the most brutal wars we've probably seen, possibly more brutal if you can compare than Sarajevo, I would say.
I wouldn't.
And with all the different sides involved as well. And it's geopolitical, maybe Bosnia was as well, but it looks pretty brutal, doesn't it?
It is brutal.
Yeah.
It is brutal. So. And all I would say that for those, and if it was, you know, if I was at that age now, I'd probably be daft enough to do something and probably be shot.
Yeah.
You know, like, and then what would be the point in that? Not only would there be a small collection of family grieving, not too many, but at the same time is that, you know, all the aid would be gone. What was it all for? So, and that's why I say to anyone now, if you want to go through the registered charities, you may feel they, you know, many, you know, go through them. If you want to help, donate.
Yeah, exactly. How do we get this book then? We've got it on to Amazon, haven't we?
Everything is on Amazon. And, you know, the three trilogies are on Amazon. The original autobiography, The Benevolence of Rogues, on there. There's even a little play I did, which is about how to deal with criticism.
Yeah.
And it's kind of like the play is called The Pain of Rejection. And pain is spelt P-A-N-E. And it's about all the mistakes I made as a writer. And it's kind of like how to deal with criticism. How do you fulfill your dream? You know, it's not a kind of like a teaching thing, but it's done with humor. And it's done in this kind of setup where you've got an author and in this case, a critic. And it's kind of like a sparring between the two.
Yeah.
But they're all available on Amazon. And Resilience, which is the next one out, is out on Black Friday.
Thanks a lot. Thanks, John, for coming to say all the best with the books, and we'll catch up soon. Thanks.
Brilliant. Thanks for this. Thanks, Mark.